Okay, I'd like to call this regular meeting back to order. And the next item of business is to accept the remainder of the agenda. Are there any suggested modifications? And hearing none, do we have a motion to accept the agenda as presented?
I move we accept the agenda as presented.
Second.
Well, okay, it's a tie there. I think LaShonda was the seconder here. Okay. That's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion on this point? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? So we have accepted our agenda. And on that agenda, then the next item is public comment. Is there anybody here wishing to address the board in any fashion? See no indication of such. So let's move on to the Urbana Park District Advisory Committee UPDEC report.
Mike, I think we have one more. Item B on the bottom of page one.
Oh, whoops.
Ellen's here with an introduction.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It's right down by the line there.
Yeah, okay. Yes, new staff introductions.
No problem. I wanted to introduce one of our interns for the semester. This is Alan Paul. He's interning over at Brookins with the athletic department, and he's a student over at Eastern Illinois University majoring in kinesiology, concentration in sport management. So I'll let him tell you a little bit more about himself.
Well, I've worked for the park district for many years. I've just as a supervisor, so in the years there I got to learn well, that side of things, but now I'm the intern, so I'm part of the administrative side of all the stuff, which I've always was curious about, so I'm just getting more experience there. Outside of working for the park district, I've recently gotten into coaching baseball. Just this past summer, actually, I got my first head coaching job after years of being an assistant, so needless to say, I got to deal with parents. Because you know they want the head coach, so I have experience with dealing with parents and sports, and so, and well, this is the first board meeting I've been to, so now I'm learning more about this.
Great, glad you're here.
Alan does a good job for us. He's very friendly and has a personality where he reaches out to people who come to visit and coaches if he's working with that. So it's been a pleasure having him around. So thanks, Alan.
We see him Mondays at volleyball every week, so.
Well, welcome aboard.
I'm aboard.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming.
Okay, now moving on to the UPDEC report. There was a written report in the board packet.
Yes. Carol's traveling at this time.
Were there questions or comments anybody had on the
UPDEC? Questions about Carol's report or UPDEC report?
No. Okay, let's move on then to our consent agenda. And on the consent agenda this evening are approval of the minutes of the February 2nd board study session, the February 9th regular board meeting, the receipt of the monthly reports from administration, planning and operations, and the recreation department, action to accept the philanthropy report and gifts listed with gratitude, and approval of the monthly paid accounts payable. And again, a reminder to those watching at home and also our commissioners, if there's any of these items that any single commissioner would like removed from the consent agenda for a separate discussion and consideration, that is the right of any single commissioner to do that. So I would ask, are there any of these items that any commissioner would like removed from the consent agenda?
No.
Okay, so we will deal with all of these in an omnibus fashion. So again, under our rules, the consent agenda itself, there will be no further discussion on these items. They are typically things that we've visited before or which are non-controversial in nature. So do we have a motion to approve in an omnibus fashion these items on the consent agenda?
I move to approve all the action items on the consent agenda and accept all the information items listed on the consent agenda in an omnibus fashion.
Second.
That's been moved and seconded, and again, there's to be no further discussion on this point. There's some items here we would like to have a roll call vote, so we'll start with Commissioner.
Aye.
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 Okay, that carries unanimously with the four commissioners present. Moving on to the financial reports.
Hello again. It's my pleasure to discuss the financial performance of the district with you for February. I'm going to begin tonight by discussing the first of two budget reports. This is called the Fund Balance Report, and this report shows the receipts and expenditures for the prior 12-month period, the budget for the current period, and the preliminary unaudited results for the 10 months ending February 29th, 2016. The first page of this report is the page that we call Sum 1. This is all funds excluding the Capital Improvements Fund. Revenues for this period were $8,148,000, $6,327,000 of which was property taxes. Expenditures were $6,911,000, and we have a surplus after 10 months. This means that there's an excess of revenues over expenditures paid of $1,238,000. The net change in fund balance shows an increase in fund balance after 10 months of $981,000. Although I can't be too sure at this point, we had budgeted a decrease in fund balance of $276,000, and I'm pretty sure we're going to beat that. We'll see as the year winds down, but I think we're in pretty good shape.
It's in a smaller...
A smaller decrease reduction. Or an increase. Yeah. So I can't say for sure yet, because we have expenditures of when you look at the treasurer's report and you see the disbursements, an average month is going to be about $500,000. So... And we still have 2 months to go. So it's going to be close, but I don't think it'll be that full budgeted decrease. Moving on to page 2. This is the report that we call Sum 2. This is the Capital Improvements Fund only. And for this period, for this 10 months, we have revenues of $98,000 and expenditures of $913,000. Expenditures exceed revenues, and that means there was a deficit of $815,000. After the total of other sources of $967,000, there is a net increase in fund balance of $152,000, which we will continue to spend down for the remainder of this fiscal year. And finally, on Sum 3, this is all funds district-wide. And I like to point out the fund balance at the end of this period, which is $6,531,000. And this will continue to decrease as the year winds down, since we are, if you notice, the net change in fund balance budgeted is a negative $478,000. So we'll see where we wind up. So we're getting close. Following that are the summary sheets for the other working funds, general, recreation, museum, and indoor pool. The next budget report is the budget analysis with history report. This report is a historical comparison of the same 10-month period of the current year and the prior 3 years. So 10 out of 12 months is 83%, which is a number you can compare to throughout the report to check for reasonableness. You can also compare prior year dollar values and prior year percentages. The first section lists all funds district-wide, and on the middle of page 2, you can see that total revenues and transfers in for this 10-month period were $11,715,000. And I've said now for the last several months that fees are performing quite well. Fees are at 86% of budget, sorry. And you can see compared to the prior 3 years, we're above for percentage-wise and dollar-wise. So we're doing pretty well there. If you move on to page 3, our expenses and transfers out for this period total $10,582,000, with an excess of revenues over expenditures at the end of February of $1,132,000. Moving on to the treasurer's report. The treasurer's report is a report of the amount of cash that the district has on one day, February 29th, 2016. All 25 funds are listed with where the cash is invested for a grand total of $8,505,790.71. Page two, the first section here lists the amount that we have in interest-bearing accounts. So of the $8,506,000 that we have, $7,500,000 of it is out in investments at some low rate. But those low rates are slowly increasing. Interest rates continue to creep up. Illinois Funds has seen a slight increase again for the third month in a row, as has Chase Savings. And you can see the biggest change on this section of the report is you can see that the CDs that we had invested in Park Pool matured, and they were kicked back into our Park Pool money market account. I worked with the investment managers at the Illinois Park District Liquid Assets Fund and reinvested them on March 2nd. So as of February 29th, they were in the money market, but 2 days later, I had them reinvested. So you'll see that change on the March reports when that they got reinvested. And the exciting thing, I left the prior interest rate on here. We had these invested, we had 4 1-year CDs invested for an average interest rate of 0.7%. And I was able to reinvest them at 1.065%. So I'm really pleased with that.
Great job.
Anywho, moving on.
It's important.
And I've seen similar increases with some of our other CD maturities. So, but those ones we have laddered in 3 and 6. And so I don't get to see it all at once, like with these 4 CDs. So anyway, the next section lists disbursements. The vendor payments on this report match the paid accounts payable in the consent agenda. And we have total disbursements for this period of $471,000. And the final section lists interfund loans. The loan between the English Fund and the indoor pool is a rollover loan for current cash flow needs at UIC. It's still at $225,000, but if you look at the front page of the treasurer's report, they're definitely going to need more in March. So it'll go up to that full 250 that the board allows us to use from the English Fund. And if we need more beyond that, we'll go ahead and make a portion of our payment to the indoor pool that the park district owes anyway for the end of the year. So we'll just make it in March if we need to. And I present the treasurer's report to you for approval.
I move we accept the treasurer's report for audit.
Second.
That's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion on this point? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That carries unanimously.
The supplemental report of cash is the next report. This report has the same information as the first page of the treasurer's report, but it groups the information by expected use rather than by fund name. The different uses are daily operating funds, restricted special needs, and restricted gifts and donations. So of the $8,506,000 that we have available, $1,569,000 is restricted, leaving $6,937,000 available as spendable cash. And finally, I will touch on the highlights of the capital budget reports. The areas highlighted with an asterisk symbol on the capital budget reports are where there's been spending or activity. So the 2016 capital budget's up and running, and this month we accepted Memorial Day donations for 2 benches, and a portion of the issuance costs were paid, and spending occurred on the design for the nature playscape pathwork. Recreation small equipment funds were spent to purchase dumbbells, medicine balls, and strength bands, and an application fee was paid for the trails grant that we're applying for. In the 2015 capital budget, this is the budget that saw the most activity. Donations came in for nature play, payments were made towards cottage construction, spending also occurred towards the Crystal Lake Sediment Basin, the Hickman Wildflower Walk, the Rain Garden Project, and finally, truck M19 was purchased. Yay. Mm-hmm. And in the 2014 capital budget, revenue from Douglas Creek donations was received and spending occurred on construction crew projects. And now Caitlin and Derek have some updates for you.
Katie. As Katie mentioned, we received the vehicle M19, which you may remember approving back in February of 2015. So that took a long time. That was largely due to the fact that Ford changed their F-150. They completely rebuilt it. And so the manufacture of those vehicles became a little tied up at the assembly lines. We had originally bid out a 2015 vehicle that we were hoping to receive basically off the lot if possible. And they had stopped manufacturing the 2015s. So instead, for the same cost, we got a brand new 2016 vehicle that was just freshly manufactured in January. So it's as top of the line as possible for an F-150 right now. So I know Joseph's, we've had some troubles with their new redesign. For example, it's all aluminum, which is going to help with rust proofing. But they put an airbag in the roof, which is usually how we assemble our radios and our lights that go on top. Luckily, Denny, our mechanic, is very creative. And so he's worked up a solution that will preserve the integrity of the vehicle as well as the appearance of our vehicles as we have them. So interesting things you learn about.
An airbag
trucks.
In the roof?
Mm-hmm. I said there's an airbag in the roof. So we have M19. It's great. It really is a very good vehicle. We will be preserving, we didn't trade in the old M19. We're preserving it for seasonal use. So it's becoming M26, I think we determined. So we have an additional vehicle in the fleet now as a result. For Nature Play, we actually just hosted our second design and engineering workshop this morning, where staff are able to review what Ratio Architecture has planned for the path, the accessible path that's going to go into the playscape, as well as landscape beds, which are going to be a major component of what we're putting together, not just for appearance and the aesthetics of the playscape, but also for kids to play with. That it'll be a lot of nature available there to be hands-on for them. So we're looking forward to that. They're going to have a couple of additional drafts of things, a few tweaks that we came up with this morning. And then we'll have a third workshop probably in April, maybe early May, and hopefully bidding out that pathwork in June is the expectation. So that's right on schedule, and I'm really excited about it. The Hickman Wildflower Walk has continued. We did a lot of the seeding in the last month or so. There's a little bit more to be done, a couple of wildflower and sedge species that were difficult to get a hold of, and so our contractors on that Cardno will continue to be on site to make sure that everything is according to specifications. But we should start seeing a few things greening up, as it was 70 degrees today. So we're excited about that. Mostly what's going to be green in the space is a cover crop. And a couple of our hopefully early bloomers, like Black-Eyed Susan, should pop up pretty quickly. But otherwise, this planting is going to require patience from everyone, ourselves included, that it really is going to take about 3 years to go through its full cycle of maturation. So, but we're excited to start seeing it growing. I had an interesting conversation with a patron while I was out fixing signs on the walk on Friday, and she was worried that we were putting in all turf grass under the trees, and so I was able to assure her that no, we have a very different definition of a wildflower walk. So I think that people are going to be very pleasantly surprised as it starts popping up.
Working on some PR, some banners to put out there.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. We understand that it has been a very drastic transition, and so we want to continue telling the story since it is going to take a while to develop, and we understand that. As you may have seen in Ellen's wonderful report, we did apply for a grant with the Illinois Department of Natural Resources through their Recreation Trails Program. We have applied for a grant for $200,000 to put in a pretty significant portion of a planned trails system at Ambucks Park. That was identified as one of our top priorities, one of our top three priorities by our trails master plan. And so we were really excited to have the opportunity to apply for that. On the flip side, we only had 2.5 weeks to do so. It took a lot of work to put together a good competitive grant in that amount of time. But we did get it in. Kara and I actually drove it to Springfield last week on Tuesday. At the time that we got it there, we were only the second park district organization of any sort to physically hand in one at the front desk that day. It's probably a sign of how little time park districts were given. And they included a new non-refundable fee. It's kind of like your college application fee where you pay $95 just for the honor of applying. And so we paid $300 out of the trails money for 2016, as Katie said, in order to have our application considered. So we're a little curious about what other park districts thought about this process. We should hear back from them anytime between April and July for a site visit. So we're looking forward to having kind of continued conversations about what was happening and what the response was like.
Does the money still exist for the program?
It's federal funds, so that's...
It is federal dollars, so they can't sweep that.
It's the only grant that they've been able to release in 2 years, basically. So it's a very limited amount of money. It's $1.5 million. 30% of it has to go to motorized trail use, 30% designated for non-motorized, and 40% is kind of a grab bag, whatever they think is best application. So that was an interesting 2 weeks there. The last one I want to update you all on is the Crystal Lake project. Kara and I also attended the Integrated Lakes Management Association conference last week, a day of it, to talk about aeration and dredging and kind of touch base with a couple of companies and people who are doing this work. We're not sure that's the direction we're going to go in, because we're still determining what's going to be the best solution for our water quality issues. But it was really good to start having those conversations in person with people who do this professionally. We are also working with Living Waters Consultants, who's on our planning team, for a mercury testing proposal. We know from at least one fish test, past fish test, that mercury was high in the lake, but we don't know if that's a systemic problem, if that's something that's in all of the sediment kind of gradually throughout the system, if there are hot spots. And it sounds like not a lot of people are actually doing this work. It's a big process. There's a lot of work that needs to go into it. I think a lot of people with lakes and ponds are kind of sweeping it under the rug. We would like to not do that. And so we're hoping to get a couple of more concrete answers about what mercury might look like in the lake, because we really don't know.
Statewide, largemouth bass have a restriction for mercury. It's that widespread throughout the state. Ours was high enough that it warranted a second test. We're still looking for those results. There's been a tremendous lag in that testing. They've since tested a crappie that was also considerably elevated. So I think our recommendation will be to move forward with doing our own testing to get an idea of what our fish contamination is, and then to test the actual sediments as well and see what's going on.
How expensive is that testing?
It's not terribly expensive.
No, for establishing the protocol and then reviewing the results, Living Waters is proposing about $3,500. It's likely to be about $200 to $250 per test that we have done after that for sediment testing. We don't know how many they're going to recommend at this point, but I imagine that the entire process will be under $10,000.
We also get reminded by staff the number of people that fish there and probably eat the catch. Mm-hmm. So obviously we feel we have a responsibility to at least get the information that we need to know. As Derek mentioned, there's other statewide information, but it might be good to know what we have.
There's a sub-consultant that Living Waters is working with that specializes in some of these areas, and he was involved in a much more contaminated site out east, and the solution they came up with was to use a nitrite application solution, which had remarkable results, but it's an ongoing care and feeding solution for them. Because of the extent of the contamination, the size of the water body, it made more sense. The sediments bound and tied to the mercury is in the sediments, and so it's increasingly looking like some sort of sediment abatement procedure may kill a couple birds with one stone, because we also know that we have the nutrient eutrophication in that lake. So we're still looking at a lot of different things, but we're trying to get a full grasp of what our challenges are before we settle on any one solution.
We're still moving towards having a second public meeting to keep everyone informed about our Crystal Lake plans. I would say that on the recreation, public recreation access side, we have a lot of good ideas that are very close to being ready to go, but the water quality side of it has us still doing a lot of research and careful consideration before we take it in front of everyone. Otherwise, I will talk to you all later about a about the cottage in a separate memo.
Okay, thank you. Moving on to the executive director's report.
A couple of things to just update and report on. As you know, I think it was passed around in the correspondence file, the Park District received the GFO Accounting Award. Wanted to thank Katie and Karen Milan and Sander Ott for their work. They do a great job, and it's become a tradition, and it's one that they are really proud of. And obviously with Katie in her role, she's extremely pleased that happened. It's a real boost and vote of confidence, so we're very pleased with that. Second, wanted to mention on February 29th, we had the IAPD Legislative Breakfast at the Virginia Theater. Had a very good turnout with our four local legislators. I think I would say, unfortunately, you know, a lot of their comments and concerns were about the state or lack of state budget. And so while that's very real and it's impacting all of us, and we know that, we still feel obligated to promote our needs for parks and recreation. Grants were one of the things I think that was highlighted. Ellen and Dana and staff worked on a beautiful handout for at least for the Park District for all of our grants that we've received that were on tabletop. So it was apparent, and I saw the legislators reading them. And I think we all spoke in various degrees of the need and the importance of that. Speaking of grants, obviously, it was just reported we applied for the RTP grant. It's both frustrating, but you need to respond. So we did, and I'm very proud of our staff for pulling together an excellent application. It's a well-deserved site. I think if anybody deserves it, we do, because we pulled things together. I did want to highlight something that Derek's promoted for a while is, you know, getting information on likely and high priority projects. So we were very fortunate, if you remember a little while back, we had employed Burns Clancy to do a more of a wider evaluation and pull things together at Ambox Park. That made it a little bit easier to get information. Public dialogue and public meetings are also things we want to be mindful of, because those things are included on the application. So, you know, looking for at least any opportunity to take project ideas forward in a public way is helpful. So we're appreciative of that, and we'll wait for that information. Wanted to thank the aquatics management team and the work Corky did on revising the indoor aquatic center agreement. Corky and I attended the school district study session March 1st and had an excellent discussion. It was very, very positive and very well received. I think some of the, you know, reasons it's simplified, it's easier to read. A lot of the construction details that went along with that first agreement 18 years ago could be pulled out and just get right down to the core things. So we're still working at the attorney review levels, and we hope to have it go back to the school district for their April board meeting.
March, sorry.
A little
next
ahead of,
week.
They have, theirs is the next week, yeah. Yes, the March meeting, and then to us in April for approval. That'd be fantastic, and we see that moving ahead. Takes a lot of effort, and appreciate the school district's time. They've been fantastic in meeting with us as well. Lastly, wanted to touch a little on some of the new news about our concerns about our budget. As you know, I think it was in the third week of February, Katie and I attended a hearing out at Brookings at the county at the Board of Review and heard, you know, basically the presentation. There was follow-up, there was no stay of that tax ruling. So that would mean that our local hospitals would resume paying their taxes. That's where it begins to present a challenge for the Park District, because we move back into that roller coaster tax arrangement where we are receiving what I call disputed dollars. In the past, we've always set those dollars aside with the idea that if called or needed to repay, you wouldn't want to not have the funds available. So kind of looking in that, staff's been very, very concerned. Katie had worked up a worksheet. Let me just pass a few out this way and this way. Wait till those go around. And also it couldn't come at a worse time because we're working on our budgets. And so what we'd normally be doing is actually doing our final descent on some of our budget things and be anticipating meeting with the finance committee to get their input, move it on to preliminary review, and then final approval for our May meeting. Does everybody have a copy of the handout? Great. And as you notice, it just says draft. It's for discussion purposes. We'll have Katie go over the numbers just so we're clear in a second, but draw your attention down below the box. And, you know, I think staff's really strongly suggesting that we're going to have to do a combination of things. We're going to need to make some cuts in spending. In fact, we're recommending us look at the rest of this fiscal year and see what kind of cuts and or postponements we can make as a way to ease moving into the next budget cycle with maybe some additional carryover or fund balance. Utilizing our reserve funds may be something we would consider, at least to some proportion. Obviously to balance or to identify, you know, these type of numbers that we need to find in the difference would take some time and discussion. And so I think what we'd recommend is putting together a budget. And lastly, working with our capital project funds. Our capital funds could be looked at in maybe some creative ways or older ways, looking at what could we cover with our capital funds in this difficult time that are legitimate expenses. I think it would be very difficult for staff to, you know, decide how to make all cuts, you know, to that proportion. But before we go in maybe into that next step, Katie, would you walk us through the 2014 levy and 15 and just show us that gap difference and explain how you see that number?
If you look at this is just the facts that we know to this date. The 2015 levy column is all estimates at this point, but we're pretty close. In talking to the county clerk's office, I know that my estimated property tax dollars to be received is within $1,000. Of what they have on their books, so we're pretty close as far as our estimates. But let me just start from the 2014 levy column. This is how this $6,332,660. That's how much property tax levy we received last year. That was our extension for the current fiscal year that we're in right now. Our tax rate was 1.2013, and the total EAV of our district was $527 million. So we didn't have to reserve anything for out of the $6 million that was paid by hospitals, so we received the entire $6 million. If you move over to the 2015 levy column, we're expected to receive our full levy. And if you recall back in October and November, we chose to levy estimated plus 6%. Do you know how we do that? Plus 6 or plus 8, and you guys choose a percentage. Well, if things had gone as we anticipated, we would have gotten the change in the CPI, 0.8%. But instead, we got plus 6%. And so in reality, we're going to get $451,000 more than we were expecting, approximately. This is all estimates. However, because of the hospital properties.
It's because those came back onto the tax roll.
Correct. Mm-hmm.
Okay. They came on as new property, and so the total EAV of Urbana now went up to $642 million approximately, and our tax rate went down by almost 15 cents. And so that leaves us with having to set, let me take a step back, this is confusing. That $111 million of hospital property is 17% of the total EAV. So at this point, we're obligated to reserve 17% of our tax extension in case we need to repay it when the Supreme Court case goes to the Illinois Supreme Court. And 17% of $6.7 million is $1.174. So that's where the $1,174,409 comes from, because it's 17% of the extension. So although we are getting $451,000 more than last year's levy, we have to reserve almost $1.2 million. And that leaves us with a $722,000 decrease in amounts available for spending from last year. Does that make sense? Any questions about that?
I think it's kind of a second part to that is any properties that were considered new construction that we couldn't capture with our rate, obviously, is a major concern. So there was approximately, what, 35 million, 36, 34?
For us, because we're tax capped in the way the tax cap law is written, prior exempt property and new property all goes on to the tax rolls as new property for us. And that's that total 111 million. So 75 million of that was prior exempt property. So that was properties that they had been paying taxes on, but then claimed exemptions for. And 36 million is related to their new property that's truly new, that's never been on tax rolls before. And that was mostly the Hart Institute. But for tax cap purposes and for our purposes, it doesn't actually make a difference in our tax calculation because it all came on as new property. But the fact is, unless we had levied plus 30%,
right,
there was no way that we were going to capture all 111 million of that. And we, we've used the term left money on the table before. Approximately $800,000 was not available to us because we didn't levy high enough to capture it. But that said, it's difficult to debate that back and forth because would it have been in good faith for us to accept all of that? And basically then the Urbana taxpayers' rates would have stayed the same. I'm not sure.
Well, another obvious thing is it wouldn't seem very responsible having no information of when that could occur. We have to be responsible every year. We do get a couple of calls about the black box and, mm-hmm. People do watch that. So I guess unless we were just willing to find a way to, just in case, come up with a number, I don't know if there would be any way we could reasonably right. anticipate that happening.
Well, it's water over the mm-hmm. dam.
It already. Is. Correct.
And if we had levied high enough to, quote, capture all of that, then we would have pulled in that $75 million, which is being, in some senses, called new property. And yet really isn't because our tax rate already included that in some ways. But we're not going to fully cover the $35 million
right.
that truly was new.
Right.
And that will have a long-term effect.
Right. Some things
that would have made the black box look pretty scary.
Right. And I think our only the only reasonable answer I could give would be, well, just in case we needed to be and if you also compare the many, many, every year before that, the boards have always carefully and thoughtfully analyzed that process mm-hmm. with the understanding that really it's appropriate to ask for the least amount that you need, mm-hmm. For your community. So I guess what we're saying is we believe that's an unavoidable situation. However, things we would like to do or consider, talk with Finance Committee is, like to check with IAPD, to see has this happened, are there any other precedents, ask about any potential with our local legislators to write any special legislation just right here for Urbana schools and parks, because the school district's also in the same situation. Ironically, we're the two groups that had settled, at least with the Carl situation, and obviously still feeling the effects of that. So we'd like to explore those options or any other ideas anybody would have or direct us or suggest to us in a way to, avoid that permanent situation. Again, due to no fault of the Park District or the Urbana taxpayers, we're being asked to deal with this situation. So it's very grave and we're very, very concerned. And as you would imagine, we don't know when it'll be resolved. So I think what we're suggesting below the box there on the handout stamp draft, that would really just, I think that recommendation is just to this next year. Beyond that, we'd recommend we spend this year, fiscal coming, working with UPDAC and the board on how we ultimately need to realign ourselves. Obviously, if there was a quick judgment and things were settled fast, that would help. But I think we asked our Park District Council, do you have any idea how long these kind of cases, obviously they can't put a date on it, but certainly more than a year, plus was suggested, and it all depends on caseloads and all of that kind of information. So I guess the short of that is we don't really have a end date that we can hope for or really kind of start to keep in focus. So again, given with that, we thought it would be very difficult to make rash or rapid decisions at that proportion without leaving, you know, a major impact. Obviously, we'd like to work with the Finance Committee and looking at all the possibilities, all the recommendations, all the considerations we know of at this time, and try to get something to rise to the top that we can get our hands around and move forward and finish our budget. And then how do we want to handle and step forward with these other more serious issues? Some things we probably should do too is visit and talk with the school district, find out how they're approaching it, talk perhaps with the city staff or the mayor, again, our legislators, probably let, you know, just touch base at the county clerk's office just to make sure we're not missing any, you know, bits of information or anything that could be helpful there, and anywhere else anybody would recommend to be helpful. But at least tonight we wanted to kind of give you a snapshot of what we think is some of the, you know, numbers, and at least one approach that we think is a little more reasonable to ease into this. Again, it's to no fault of the Urbana taxpayer, the district, or any of the staff. We're just being impacted by this, as others are. But it's a pretty heavy hit to Urbana, again, and I think there's a lot of concerns. And with that, if there are any comments, otherwise we could move on to our agenda.
How realistic do we think it would be to have legislation written to address this? Or how interested would our local legislators be in this?
We'd want to ask, but Katie, do you want to mention at least the one legislative piece you note that it wasn't approved? But.
Right. When I did some research, there were two bills that didn't make it past the House. One was in 2005 and one was in 2014 that were called tax recapture laws. And they were similar to the situation that, you know, a district didn't levy enough to recognize changes in EAV that came after their levy had to be submitted. And they wanted the opportunity to collect the increase in the EAV in a future levy. They didn't make it past the House. One thought is that perhaps they were statewide. And perhaps having a targeted legislation for just Urbana Park District and School District, or just Urbana, might be more favorable.
Obviously, because it's very specific, mm-hmm. So it might be possible. Again, we don't know, but those are things we feel compelled we need to seek out and see if we can get righted. One of the worst impacts is, you know, our taxpayers have stuck with us through thick and thin. And we've achieved a lot of great things. We've got many things to be proud of. Now this new curve is very challenging. So while rightly so, the taxpayers getting immediate relief on their tax bill, at the same time, their schools and parks are being impacted. And I'm gonna suggest it's a lose-lose situation, because while they're paying their fair share, they're gonna be impacted by the possibility that we'd have to repay those dollars back. And so I guess I don't think probably one thing the staff didn't assume is that we would just, you know, spend dollars that come to us with no regard for tomorrow. That has not been our way. We've not treated it in the past. So that's why I think we moved to a sort of a graduated proposal of using a variety of sources. But certainly it'd be the board's purview to, you know, direct staff any way you would see appropriate.
Well, my opinion is we are going to have to take a careful look at this and try to do some kind of a hybrid, but we cannot afford to be hanging out there with the possibility of having to refund a chunk of money that we don't have enough resources to cover. And
common sense.
Maybe we could do a combination of existing fund balances versus sequestering all of this stuff, some hybrid between those two. Mm-hmm. But the crunch could become even more severe if this is not finally resolved in the Supreme Court this year.
Absolutely.
We got to be prepared to deal with a similar situation next year until Absolutely. There's an actual definitive final decision. I think it would be imprudent of us to spend that money.
I think that's the staff perspective as well.
And then just to make sure, it's sort of still mucky, but because we weren't able to levy enough. If the Supreme Court would rule in favor of Carl and they went back off the roll, then our tax rate has also been lowered.
No. Well, it has been for this year, but yeah. If the Supreme Court were to rule in favor of Carl and they were again granted exemption, then our levies based on the dollars we received the prior year. So we did capture an additional $450,000, and that amount will remain in future years, but now the remaining taxpayers' rates will increase
again
to allow us to continue to levy that amount.
Gotcha.
So
doesn't fall all over again.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, we have a lot of things riding on this. We just mentioned we applied for a grant. There's some match requirements for that. Obviously, we'd have to look at everything. What makes sense? What's a good investment? And what do we have to put on hold for now? But again, it's just very difficult because we've been sort of caught in this, you know, situation for a long period, and it's difficult to move forward. And ironically, when we look at Crystal Lake, our highest need that came from our 2007 strategic plan and master plan, and we were just gearing up to start, might put things on hold. We should also be talking closely with our foundation. Are there opportunities, you know, where we might work together in a way to meet more immediate needs as opposed to longer term sort of approaches? So I think there's probably work for everybody here to do that, and we don't have a lot of time. Normally we'd have a draft budget. Our goals would be in draft. We'd be probably talking about that instead, or leading up to our April study session. So it came at a bit of surprise, and we're going to land on our feet. We recommend we keep a cool head, use prudent judgment, look in the long term, both in the short term, and try to keep our, you know, staff and properties at the highest regard. Things we probably need to consider in the, you know, in broad brushing, you know, is partnerships and things that we're paying and costing, any financial arrangements that could be put on hold or delayed, looking at our capital budget maybe in a new way. We have some thoughts on that we'd like to share with the Finance Committee. So that's kind of where we are tonight, and don't really have any more concrete information.
Yeah, we've really only known and been working on the plan for this for a week.
Right.
So, and you know, typically I wouldn't present a preliminary budget to the board until the April board meeting, and I have all of the work done already to present that information to begin our discussions at Finance Committee. So I'm way ahead of schedule because I've worked on the weekends to get it done since I found out about this. But you know, that's a good thing. So we have more time to plan.
Well, it's almost like a roulette wheel where you're setting $1 million aside every year. The court decides we get it or we give it to the Carl.
Right.
And so we have that big a cut for all those years.
Yeah.
Or potentially we could have a
more robust program.
A big bonus at the end, 5 years down the road.
We like hopeful thinking. So.
Well.
Yeah, it's a good thought.
It makes rational planning very difficult.
Mm-hmm. It does. That's all I had to update, though, Michael, and board.
Well, thank you. We'll be coming revisiting this, I'm sure. Moving on to the president's report, as already mentioned, talking of the Finance Committee will be meeting on the 18th of this month. So I think. That's a week from this Friday, I believe, mm-hmm. And revisiting some of these issues. Coming board meetings, we do have an April 5th study session, which almost certainly will include an executive session for us to be able to discuss our compensation plans vis-a-vis the implications of the budget situation. And hopefully goals and objectives for the coming fiscal year and discussion of UPDAC nominations. And then for April 12th, regular board meeting, depending, we may again need to have an executive session. It's because we do have to make some choices with regards to compensation. There'll likely be some bid approvals coming up on the April 12th, and one would hope we can authorize our wage and salary and merit actions by then, although I assume there is some chance that that will bleed later to a later month.
It definitely could, and I just wanted to mention too, obviously, goals and objectives generally are more worked out in detail. We'll be working on the fly, so it may be more draft form, but we should have something.
And obviously, accepting the preliminary budget for the coming fiscal year, we would normally be doing that in April, and there may be implications for that, and revising current year capital projects budget, there's likely to be implications for that one way or another, whether we can move rapidly on that. So all of these things may be on the agenda in April and then have to be revisited later. So it's going to be an exciting spring. And so I don't have anything further in terms of President's report, and I guess then moving on to the committees, I already mentioned the Finance Committee will be meeting in a week and a half. Policy Committee.
We haven't met. The final draft of the policy is in the new business. So I'll defer any comments to that.
Okay. And Urbana Parks Foundation?
So we met in February, continuing to work on or have discussions around fundraising activities and campaigns. We're also working on a website redevelopment project as well. And then we did discuss, I believe, a date for the annual dinner, but I don't know if that's been shared with the board.
Oh, okay.
Are you guys aware? Did we talk about this already? That's because it's a weekday.
Yeah.
Did we?
We can send out that.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
April 28th.
April 28th.
Yeah. I want to say that they were very receptive to the idea of having a joint, if that was my responsibility, I apologize. I also proposed two ideas, that one we meet with more frequency, which actually had a pretty good reception, especially the idea of having a business type of meeting before the annual dinner. They thought that was a great idea. Although the president was absent, the vice president, I should say Fred, was on his way to New Zealand. But in general, that was well received. And so we had talked about that as well last time in a study session. So I think that is all that I have for the foundation.
Any questions for Meredith? Okay. Moving on to the ad hoc committee. With regards to UpDeck planning, is there anything to report, LaShawna?
We met, what day was that? About 3 weeks ago. And we pretty much piggyback off what we talked about last time, just still trying to identify some ways to draw more interest to UpDeck and how to retain some of the members. We have some that, you know, kind of fall off sometimes due to other obligations, and highlight some goals moving forward, some things that ideally we like to see UpDeck work on, maybe as a group. We talked about subcommittees, still continuing on with the subcommittees, and we're going to meet again next month, I think, in April. To continue that conversation and try to solidify some things before the actual new committee comes on board.
Exactly. I think it's fair to say too, this particular committee is probably going to be ongoing. I don't know if there's a completion. Doesn't mean we're meeting every month, but we're ongoing, and the idea is to share information, talk with UpDeck, work with every way we can to make that a better experience. not to say it's not a great experience, but it's good to get feedback. And it helps our organization.
Thank you. Okay, moving on to old business. The first item there is action to approve ordinance 2016-01, revising personnel policies of the Park District.
Alex Ivanovas here to walk us through and answer any questions. Thank you, Alex.
Okay. So we're talking about section 4 of the personnel policy manual. The two differences in your packets from last month are Michael's edits. We incorporated those, and then we're also including like entity comparisons in the packet. It's not stapled to it, it's the last page. And other than that, the bulk of the material hasn't changed. We're still proposing adding Martin Luther King Day and Veterans Day as observed holidays to the district. And we're also recommending that paid leave and acute illness accrual cease for employees on a leave of absence. In addition to those, cell phone reimbursement is recommended to cease at the beginning of a leave of absence, and after a 6-month leave of absence, we're proposing that the Park District would no longer be paying premiums for that employee. And any questions?
I was just going to add, as noted in the annotated agenda, ideally we'd like to have it, 30 days notice to notify staff. We have staff meetings anticipated coming up. We could share, those changes. So
I should have stated that all these changes are effective May 1, not
thank you.
Right after.
Yep. We thought, obviously, from the beginning of this review that the fiscal year would be a reasonable start.
And this is something that we have reviewed once before. And have now been provided the additional information about some other agencies and the holidays they observe.
And also, just a reminder, this is all part of our regular policy review. As we're going through the policies on a scheduled basis with the policy committee, these are things that became apparent and led to discussion and recommendations by staff and the policy committee as well.
Well, I move to approve ordinance 2016-1, adopting revisions to the Urbana Park District personnel policies in section 4.00, paragraphs 4.02, paid leave, 4.03, holidays, 4.04, acute illness, and 4.05, family or medical leave.
Second.
That's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion on this point? Hearing no indication of that, this should be a roll call vote. I'll start over to the right.
Aye.
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 Okay, and that carries unanimously with the four commissioners present voting in the affirmative.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Alex.
Thanks, Alex.
There was no old business removed from the consent agenda, so we can move on now to new business. First item being ordinance 2016-03, revising the fund balance policy. So we're back to Katie.
Back to me. This was a discussion we had at the finance committee level. I emailed the full board this exact document so that they could have a chance to review it ahead of this meeting, since we did not have a chance to meet at the policy committee level, but it seemed basic enough to increase your minimum fund balance requirements in one fund that the finance committee thought that it was okay to move forward with presenting this for approval. The idea is that when we first had our liability insurance policy, we were under the impression we were subject to one $50,000 aggregate deductible for the year, but it turns out there's a separate aggregate deductible for each type of coverage, and there's 5 different types of coverage. So in the highly unlikely event that we would have multiple claims in multiple types of coverage, you could exceed potentially the $50,000 aggregate deductible in one year. That'd be really difficult, I think, to do, but it is possible. And I think in order to plan carefully for such an event, we should increase the fund balance requirements for the liability fund to $200,000 to $300,000 rather than the $100,000 to $150,000 that was currently in the policy. Another idea that we have going forward is if we can build up some additional fund balance in the liability fund, the iParks has offered to increase our aggregate deductible to $100,000, and we could see about a $13,000 savings in our premiums if we do that. But right now, the liability fund doesn't really have enough fund balance reserves to cover a loss that great. And so we would want to build that up for a short time before we try to increase our aggregate deductibles in order to reduce premiums. But so this was just the first step in more steps to come of changing our policy to increase the aggregate.
So if we're increasing the general liability fund, are we decreasing something somewhere else?
No, this is just a target. So we're not actually doing anything other than basically making a statement that we'd like to save money in this fund, that we'd like to have a reserve built up in this fund. So no, there are five funds that have fund balance targets: recreation, museum, general, and IMRF, and liability. So those are the five funds that are identified in the fund balance policy as requiring a reserve. And each fund has different targets. So I believe the general fund is requiring between 50% minimum to 2/3 maximum for expenditures for the year as their fund balance reserve. So, and then the general and museum are much smaller than that. But anyway, this particular fund just had a dollar figure between 100 and 150, and I'm suggesting that we double that to 200 to 300. Doesn't mean that we're there, we're not there. I think the fund balance in the liability fund is around $100,000 right now, but my hope would be that we could build it up.
And you said it'd save us $13,000?
It would save us $13,000 in premiums if we change our policy to have a higher deductible.
So if we had an extra $100,000 in there, it'd be like $13,000 interest on $100,000, which is a lot higher than we get in our
I guess bonds. So. Right now, the total annual premiums for our insurance policy is $179,000. That doesn't include claims. So the claims is another $50,000 aggregate. Mm-hmm. For each of the five types. We budget for 50,000. I think it would be, we haven't spent it at this point.
I mean, if we went to a higher deductible, it would certainly behoove us to have an even larger still fund balance.
Exactly. But that 179,000 in premiums paid, that's where we'd see the savings, the $13,000 savings that was quoted to us. We didn't accept it this year because I didn't feel comfortable, but after talking with Michael, I think we'll probably proceed with that option for this year when we renew in October, because we did, even though the fund doesn't have the we can discuss more at finance committee, but the thought was that even if the fund didn't have the reserves yet, you could always offset with the transfer from general in the case of a claim. So
it's good planning, and we're glad you did some digging to at least learn that and figure that out and make the recommendation.
We've known it. Dottie figured it out a couple of years ago in talking with iParks, and we were really surprised actually to learn that there were five different aggregate deductibles, but it is what it is, and that's our policy. So we want to work with what we have there.
I move to approve ordinance 2016-03, revising the fund balance policy.
Second.
That's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion on this point? We need a roll call vote, and let's start at the left this time.
Aye.
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 Okay, and that carries unanimously, again, with the four commissioners present all voting in the affirmative. Next item of business is resolution 2016-01 to apply for a City of Urbana Community Development Block Grant for youth scholarships.
Ellen's here to give us some background and any other impos you'd like to share about that?
This is a grant that we apply for annually at the city, and usually we get it. The last couple of years, we have not. They get many more requests than they have the ability to fund. But in the past, this has always gone to support youth scholarships for specifically summer day camp, child care services for Urbana residents who, you know, have no other way really to afford child care for their children. So, you know, we apply for scholarships. They must go to Urbana residents, and they must be used for summer day camps or in those months generally. So this is a resolution asking for the go-ahead by the board to make the application, which will be going in the end of April.
And the grant application requires such a resolution.
It does. I'm sorry. Yes, it does require that the board give their approval in order to make the application.
It's almost an annual activity, but yes.
How much is the value of the scholarships?
We apply for anywhere between, usually we ask for at least $10,000. We've never gotten that full amount. It's been anywhere from 4,000 up to 7 or 8. It just is a range.
I move to approve resolution 2016-01 to apply for City of Urbana Community Development Block Grant CDBG for youth scholarships.
Second.
Okay, that's moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion on this point? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? And that carries unanimously. Action to approve change order number 4 to the Leal Cottage Construction Repairs Contract.
So I promised I would talk more about the cottage tonight. We've had a lot of progress to the point where actually I told a few staff people just today that they can start moving things back into their offices, which is very exciting. That doesn't mean the staff are moving yet. We're going to maintain everybody's voicemail and computers here until we're actually ready to go. But we're in much better shape than we were before on the interior of the building. In fact, Rogard's installed all of the furniture in the last week and a half. It looks fabulous. We're still cleaning. We're still getting Remco Electric, getting all of the emergency exit lights up to code before we bring in the City of Urbana building inspector. Little details like that before we can make an official move. Tonight's memo is, because there is just a little bit of additional work that Grunlow is working on. That includes trim over the exterior waterproofing. The waterproofing that was done was brought all the way up, covering all of the exterior brick, and is unattractive. And so we've added some of the same material that the ramp was built out of. The Trex plastic lumber material is now covering part of that waterproofing. There will also be landscaping and regrading of the soils to help with that appearance as well. They installed exterior hose bibs. They are adding treads to the interior basement stairs, and they relocated data and telephone outlets for us to create a good finished professional appearance in the offices in the multipurpose room. These four items come to $4,344.51. Which is typically an amount small enough for staff to approve. However, the total of all change orders for Grunlow at this point comes to just over $28,000, putting us into board approval territory. Pending the approval of change order number 4, there's a remaining $13,500 in contingency for Grunlow. I know of no other work that they'll be doing. There's the possibility of some exterior work because they do the grading and reseeding. That won't happen until mid-April to May, potentially. But that amount, luckily, is still a good cushion for Grunlow, so I'm glad that we increased that contingency amount. So tonight, that's the only thing we're asking for formal approval from the board. I did want to give updates that we are closer and closer to the total expenses coming to that $353,000 point before giving back the contingency for Grunlow, before giving back the $14,000. There are many small things and small bills involved in moving telephones and staff and getting new emergency exit lights and landscaping and things like that. We believe that we've captured the vast majority of that at this point, that these numbers are very up to date. And I'm hopeful that this is the entirety of the story moving forward, and that in the next 2 weeks, staff will be moving back into the building and using it.
I move that we approve change order number 4 for the amount of $4,344.51 for the Leal College or Cottage building repair construction contract with Grunlow Construction.
Second.
That's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion on this point? This kind of contract change will call a will require a roll call vote. Starting.
Aye.
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 That carries unanimously with all four commissioners voting.
I can't recall if it was reported to you all or not, but you may remember we had a meeting here where the rain was pounding so hard that we couldn't actually hear. Mm-hmm. I checked the cottage afterwards. The basement was completely dry. So
great.
Great news. Yay. We're very happy. Was that last month? I think it was last month.
I hope after $353,000. Oh, right.
It'd be really dry.
We don't want to hear rain. Right. I think rain.
Okay, and lastly, action to award portable toilet bid, a 3-year bid here.
I love that I have this
something we've never done before.
Something exciting. And I told Shane he didn't have to come because I wasn't sure how long we were going to be, but he was willing to come talk to you guys about how important portable toilet services are in our parks, and they are incredibly important. For a large portion of the year, we can't have our pavilions and our built-in restrooms active because we can't run water to them. And so that means that we have portable, non-accessible, and accessible toilets outside of our pavilions at Meadowbrook, at Crystal Lake Park. The whole list is here, actually, if you guys are interested in it. And then in a variety of places over the summer that get the summer seasonal use but don't require a built-in pavilion toilet, and that includes places like Chief Chemauger right here, Canaday, Prairie, places where people typically where our sports fields are, soccer, baseball, and then others like the dog park getting year-round service where it would be impractical to build something at this time. Typically, for about, my understanding is about 25 years. And in the last three or four years, more formally as a formal public bid, Kemper Industrial Equipment and Illinois Portable Toilets, our two in-town portable toilet companies, have been very cutthroat, neck and neck, out-competing each other, out-bidding each other, year after year. We've had both of their services before. We've always been happy with them. They both do excellent work. Usually we do just a 1-year bid, and a 1-year bid comes to under $20,000, which is why you've never seen it before. This year it was recommended to us that we could potentially save money and certainly save staff time by doing a 3-year bid window and pooling it all together. So that's what we did. We bid it for 3 years. And the low bidder was Kemper Industrial Equipment, who has our current bid. And that bid came to $56,523.75 for 3 years. This is a little different from my usual budget reports because this money doesn't come out of the capital budget. This is operating funds. And so we would be setting how much money would be going into the operating budget for the next 3 fiscal years covering this. We do recommend a little bit of a 20% contingency. We add additional units based on need, based on special events, thinking about things like Bear coming to Meadowbrook Park potentially in the fall, where we would need additional portable toilets or music festivals in Crystal Lake Park, things like that. And so that's what those contingency amounts would go towards. In my budget estimations, I divided it out by 3 years just evenly. And we would evaluate kind of as we went fiscal year to fiscal year how much was actually being spent. So we're very comfortable, confident with Kemper Industrial Equipment. We did run the numbers. We're not totally sure we actually saved a lot of money by doing this. The prices seemed to have actually, we were expecting a linear trend of increases over the last 4 years, and it actually went up and down. So there seems to be some annual variance in portable toilet services. I don't know what the explanation is. Certainly, like I said, though, we will be saving staff time and money, as Shane and I don't need to bid it or worry about the contract for 3 years, which is good news to us. In the future, we might consider doing our 1 year and then adding alternate second and third years to see if it actually saved us money or if we would rather go out and keep it more competitive. Certainly, the difference in price between Kemper Industrial and Illinois Portable Toilets was a much larger jump than it has been in previous years. And that was across the board. That was for their price for ADA, for non-ADA units, for Sunday services. Every single thing was just that much more. It was about a 20% increase over what Kemper had bid.
So. Caitlin, I have a question. Normally, yeah. I wouldn't even ask it, but we just discussed budget and the potential of changes in the future. Would we have a way to reduce, or what's our obligation, you know?
We, since this will be contracted, we could always issue change orders.
But we're contracted for this rate.
Yes.
Normally we wouldn't do that, but if a situation arose where, you know, we had to think differently about what we were offering, mm-hmm. would we be a way to reduce that? Or are we, I'm assuming there would be a way to reduce that.
Yes, I think so.
You wouldn't be obligated just to pay that fee no matter if you were using it or not.
Mm-hmm. Right. Also, certainly, since this money includes $11,000 in contingency, I do not expect that we would spend that.
Right. And I'm assuming maybe the others wouldn't know. Sometimes we get requests for additional units or there's a change in programming, or so we need some flexibility.
Right.
I'm assuming that's what that's for.
This is a little complicated, but typically those extra units have actually come out of the program areas budgets, to my knowledge. So for example, if Janet needed extra ones at the Lake House for something, it would be coming out of Janet's budget.
I see.
This way, I think that we would be containing it more, all of that extra flex into this budget line and not have the program budgets worry about it as much.
Got it.
It's also important to note that we use our ADA capital
correct
/ services funds mm-hmm. to pay for the porta potties.
Yeah, porta potties.
Yeah.
So are they included in this?
They're included
in the bid, but
yes.
So how much of the operating fund?
It's really the ADA capital funds okay. that go to pay for these.
Interesting capital side note fund. About that. Our special rec funds that we receive.
We have a ADA, the operating, the 2.25%. Yeah. That goes to operating budget, but then we have the 1.75, whatever it is, one that goes towards ADA projects
right.
and inclusion aids mm-hmm. and porta potties.
Right.
ADA porta potties.
ADA.
Right.
I was going to add on to Corky's comment.
They are not actually capital dollars.
No. It's the portion.
They're not specifically earmarked capital
that's
dollars.
That's why it's no. services as well, yeah. 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 yeah.
We're not cheating.
No, no.
Right, right.
Interesting. We've over the years discussed, you know, Urbana Park District's always used, well, since we had the funds through the the special rec funds for quite a while for restrooms and the accessible units. In discussion with Champaign Park District, I think they're going to move to that approach also. So I think for a number of years we were doing that and trying to justify mm-hmm. why. To us, it makes perfect sense because that's where our users are. In fact, we hear people that use the portable toilets that are the accessible models. They like them better. There's more room. They have a child with them. It's easier to maneuver inside. So that's not why we're doing it, but it's just interesting to note they see that as a value now.
It's also a large part of why our budget did fluctuate considerably over the last few years, because they did not have those units on hand.
That's right.
They had smaller ADA units, but when we look closely at what was required, it required a much larger ADA unit. I've seen them. They're monstrous.
Roomy.
Yeah, I think it was 2000.
Picture seeing a wheelchair inside one, or a walker, or any other device.
There was a new, the new model, I think, came out around 2013.
Meredith, to answer your question, the amount that we receive from the special rec dollars to pay directly for ADA porta potties is around $16,000 the last couple of years.
So this really isn't saving money, just to staff time, which also saves money. Because I was looking for a comparison. It's hard to, of what you had paid in the last 3 years. Like, was it 18? Was it 19?
Last year was about, was just around 17 before you brought in any, that was just the contract with none of the flexible additional expenses, which probably was $2,000 or $3,000 more. The year before that was 18.5, and the year before that was 15.5, which is why it was really hard to, which is why we left out any analysis of what the trend had been, because there really wasn't a trend. I think it'll be interesting to see over the next 3 years what those services look like. We're locked in at a rate. We are. And there's every potential that in 3 years that rate would have gone up substantially, and we will be locked in and we will save a lot of money. We don't know that now.
Well, given the spread between the two bidders, one might imagine if we'd gone for a one-year contract, there'd been a significant jump.
It could have been. It's certainly from the jump between the bidders and the jump between Illinois Portables last year, which was about 19.5, and this year's, which is about 24. Something must be happening in the industry. That would be my read on it. Oh, sorry, I should add, the other problem is we did consider, should we rebid this? Should we pull it and say, no, we want a one-year bid? Portable toilet servicing is a very tricky time window where the contract expires March 15th, and they could pull all of the porta potties if you're not ready with your next contract. And if the opposite bidder had won, you need to keep the window tight enough that the other group doesn't pull their porta potties in frustration with you and losing the bid.
They're very competitive. That's why we wouldn't be.
I think you're all getting it.
There are accusations that without a sealed bid, you know, was there some impropriety taking place? So they were that close, the bids were. And so we felt like a sealed bid, even though it wasn't required by law, was the way to go. And it's interesting how competitive these two companies are. The numbers, if you divide by three without the contingency, is 18.8.
Right.
It's very close to what it was 2 years ago. So if you presume that the next 3 years costs will go up, which they almost certainly will somewhat, it's a reasonable bid.
Right. Yeah, simple spike in gas prices would potentially cause that.
I move that we award the porta potty bid 3 years in the amount of $56,523.73 to Kemmer Industrial Equipment Company of Champaign, Illinois, and to assign a contingency of 20% or $11,304.75 for an additional services over the same 3 year period.
And is there a second to that motion?
Second.
That was kind of a tie, so we have a second and a third. Any further discussion on the portable potties? Hearing none, roll call vote, starting with LaShonda.
Aye.
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 That carries unanimously. There was no new business action from the consent agenda. So we're down to comments from commissioners. Are there Any items that commissioners would like to bring up?
Just that I think if it's possible, it would be really useful to have this to share with the foundation. Mm-hmm. Mostly the $722,000 number.
That's a big number.
It's yep. a big number. But yep. I mean, I think that this is really important in terms of the short-term and long-run planning. Mm-hmm. So something that we could share with them at the next meeting would be great.
When's the next meeting?
March.
Be up.
Not this, not a week from following That's Monday.
It. Two Mondays.
Yeah.
Fundraising's next week.
Mm-hmm. I think it's the 21st.
Yeah.
March, Monday, sorry. Monday,
even
March
Even just
21st.
This document having copies, I'm sure that Tim and I can.
Yep. Walk everybody through.
And Michael, I'll just stand back and let the experts. But I mean, I think that this is really important. Component for them.
Well, since you brought it up, I do feel compelled to mention, yes, I think staff did talk about it, just kind of a general concern if, and again, it's a lot of speculation. We don't even have the program worked out as far as, you know, what specifics, but we have spent a lot of time talking, you know, project and site-based needs versus endowment or long-term. Obviously, if it turned out, we're speculating in a concerned way from the staff, you know, if we had lots of interest in an endowment approach, that's great news and that's never a bad thing, but it would likely or potentially, you know, hold up dollars that we might have, but we wouldn't have accessible to do any improvements. So it's just back to that question of balance that
right.
we've brought up.
I
you know,
think it depends
times.
On the nature of the donor as well. So if somebody is interested in seeing, you know, the gifts, their gift come to fruition, there's an opportunity to give to current projects
right.
and current use, or is, you know, long-term, it just depends on the donor.
Yep.
But we definitely have needs for both.
Right. And I think we've all talked to, you know, typically donors sort themselves out. They identify with something strong and that usually guides their, you know, thinking, but just be happy to talk with them at our next opportunity.
Anything else? Okay, we've exhausted our agenda, so I will declare us adjourned.